Herzlich willkommen, liebe Studierende, liebe Gäste, liebe Kolleginnen und Kollegen, zum heutigen Vortrag im Rahmen der Reihe Machtwechsel im Osten Europas, Politik und Gesellschaft im Wandel. Heute geht es um Moldawien. Der Titel des Vortrags heute ist Moldova after 3 decades of independence, political instability, social challenges, future prospects. Zu Beginn einige kurze, einfach technische und organisatorische Hinweise. Erstmal, dieser Vortrag wird aufgezeichnet als Podcast und ich begrüße auch alle, die später zuhören, also ab morgen. Aber wichtiger noch, 2 Hinweise vorab. Es stehen noch 2 Veranstaltungen im Rahmen dieser Reihe an, also die in 2 respektive 4 Wochen zu Ukraine und zu Belarus. Und wie schon vorher angekündigt, wird die Podiumsdiskussion am 9. Dezember online per Zoom stattfinden und neu aber auch der nächste Vortrag am 25. November von Wilfried Jilge wegen einer Terminkollision. Das verlagern wir also auch in den digitalen Raum. Wir werden die Zoom-Links zu beiden Veranstaltungen einfach auf der Webseite am Tag der Veranstaltung aufstellen und im Ilias habe ich sie schon deponiert. Also da finden Sie eigentlich schon alles, dass Sie wissen, in 2 Wochen können Sie alle auch live von zu Hause teilnehmen und dann Ihre Fragen eben wie im Chat stellen oder hinterher in der Diskussion. Ja, das heißt, heute ist das letzte Mal im Rahmen dieser Reihe, wo wir uns live sehen. Das finde ich schön und ich freue mich, dass ich unser heutiges Thema und die Referentin kurz vor Ort einleiten kann. Ja, was wissen Sie so über Moldawien? Also wenn es Ihnen wie mir geht, dann wissen Sie relativ wenig, viel zu wenig eigentlich über eine historische Region und einen Staat, der so seit Jahrhunderten im Grenzbereich zwischen Russland bzw. der Ukraine im Osten und Rumänien und im weiteren Sinn dem mittleren und westlichen Europa diesen Grenzbereich bildet. Und das galt für das 20. Jahrhundert, in dem Moldawien zeitweise zu Rumänien, dann wieder zur Sowjetunion gehörte. Und es gilt natürlich jetzt ganz besonders auch nach dem Zerfall der Sowjetunion im 21. Jahrhundert. Vor ziemlich genau einem Jahr ist die proeuropäische Kandidatin der Opposition Maia Sandu zur Präsidentin gewählt worden. Und gerade eben vor 2 Wochen war Moldawien mal wieder in den Medien, nachdem ein wochenlanger Streit Moldawiens mit Gazprom vorläufig beigelegt werden konnte, der die Abhängigkeit des Landes von seinem russischen Nachbarn eben nur allzu deutlich gezeigt hat. Ja, und über all diese Themen wird uns unsere heutige Referentin etwas erzählen, die uns die Entwicklung Moldawiens seit dem Ende der sozialistischen Ära etwas näher bringt. Frau Dr. Habil Svetlana Suveica kommt zu uns aus Regensburg, wo sie gestern ihr Habilitationsprojekt verteidigt hat, erfolgreich, und dazu möchte ich ganz herzlich gratulieren. Sie ist also quasi zum ersten Mal hier als PD, super, mit das Projekt hieß Ambivalent Reconfigurations of the Post-Imperial Space, a Transnational Design for Post-World War I Bessarabia. Ja, Frau Suveica hat Geschichte studiert an der Staatlichen Universität in Chișinău, also in Moldawien, und dann promoviert in Iași in Rumänien zur Integrationspolitik Bessarabiens in Rumänien nach dem Ersten Weltkrieg. Sie lehrt seit den späten 90er Jahren in Chișinău, momentan als Assistenzprofessorin an der Fakultät für Geschichte und Philosophie. Sie hat aber auch ihr zweites Standbein in Regensburg nach zahlreichen Zwischenaufenthalten an verschiedenen Orten, wo sie zum ersten Mal 2012 als Humboldt-Stipendiatin hergekommen ist und mittlerweile sowohl am Lehrstuhl für Geschichte Südost- und Osteuropas der Uni Regensburg lehrt, als auch eben als wissenschaftliche Mitarbeiterin bzw. Stipendiatin am Institut für Ost- und Südosteuropa-Forschung in Regensburg arbeitet. Und ihre Forschungsschwerpunkte eben liegen auf der südosteuropäischen Geschichte mit einem speziellen Fokus auf Moldawien, Bessarabien und Rumänien, zeitlich auf der Geschichte des 20. Jahrhunderts, Zwischenkriegszeit, Zweiter Weltkrieg, Holocaust, besonders auch in Bessarabien und Transnistrien und auf dem imperialen Erbe in Südosteuropa ganz allgemein. Ja, damit bin ich am Ende und ich freue mich, das Wort übergeben zu können.
Vielen Dank für die Einladung. Ich freue mich sehr, heute zu sein und ich möchte über mein Heimatland Moldawien jetzt auf Englisch berichten und nicht berichten, aber meine Meinung nachteilen, weil die heutige Situation in Moldawien ist nicht mein Forschungsschwerpunkt. Ja? Aber ich möchte gerne auch Fragen oder Kommentare auf Deutsch nehmen. Ja, many thanks for the invitation once again to come to Bern and reflect critically on Moldova. The country which I, at the moment, I'm not living there, but I'm going often, and obviously it's also a subjective part of history here. Nevertheless, I will try to share with you today some ideas about Moldova during the last three decades, starting from 1991, when this country became independent, so former Soviet Republic. Yes, so here you see the regional map of Moldova, so Moldova on the regional map, in fact, bordering with Ukraine on your right and with Romania, a new member state on the left. And on your right, I have put together a chronological account on the region. The main points of the regional history during the last two centuries. So I will refer to some of those dates during my talk. So you see 19th century, the Bessarabian gubernia within the Russian Empire, which became in 1918 a Romanian province to be transformed in Moldavian Soviet Socialist Republic in 1940. So between 1941 and 1944, Bessarabia regained the status of Romanian province, while today Transnistria was part of a larger Transnistrian region between the rivers Dnister and Bug, you see it on the map, which was administered by Romania. After the war, the Moldavian Soviet Socialist Republic was restored. It was 1 year of Soviet Moldova, you see here 1940-1941. The autonomous Transnistrian Republic of the interwar period was incorporated into Moldovan Soviet Socialist Republic. So on August 27, 1991, which is a holiday, a special day for Moldovans, Moldova declared independence from the Soviet Union. So my overview analysis would be focused on Moldovan developments during the last decades, on political evolution and societal changes, a bit of reflection in the end on the future perspective of the country. Historical perspective is what I would like to focus on. And if you are attentive to recent studies, they have engaged in comparing the years of 1918, 1945, and 1989, specifically for our case, 1991, as the immediate transformation. After this year, the immediate transformation that occurred on the one hand, and on placing the history of Eastern Europe in a broader global context on the other. So scholars such as Adam Tooze, Philip Ter have widened the time span of transition or transformation you would find in the literature by including the post-war social phenomena, which comprised also adaptation to change. So you see some reference point of comparison, such as regime changes and conflicts, sometimes violent conflicts, nationalizing policies, identity clashes, integration, disintegration processes, transition and contingency within this transition, of course, elite analysis, who led the transformation, so the old and new elite, and last but not least, transition seen at the memory, transition in connection with the memory of the traumatic past. So that's comparative studies of 1945-1989 have demonstrated this challenge of a double transformation that occurred after this date. So on the political status and also on the regime type. If we are talking about 1991, the dissolution of the Soviet Union, so this transformation so from the Soviet Empire to the independent state, and also from authoritarianism to democracy. So as far as we know, the disintegration of the Soviet Union took place relatively peacefully. But the outcome was often presented as inevitable, and only in recent years the contingency factors during the transition were observed more closely. Here I mean that the so-called double transformation did not entail the immediate erasure of the previous regime. The previous regime was embodied in administration, financial, social development, and identity. So during the post-1991 time, knowledge and abilities acquired in the communist regime were readjusted and reused. I will refer to this point during my presentation. To say a couple of words on the issue of the past, the traumatic past. We are used to talk about the post-World War I period, post-World War II period, but not necessarily about 1991 being understood as a war, because it was not a war in itself. Nevertheless, there are scholars who, such as Peter Apor or Henry Rousseau, who have identified post-91 as post-war period, exactly due to this problematic historical consciousness, which rejected the communist past and avoided connecting the memory of communism with that of crucial events such as World War I and World War II. The last decade gave birth to new concepts such as conflicting memories, dividing memories, and coping with the past. Still, with reflection, the last decades, we do not see very much discussion about the former Soviet regions and the past the society had to manage, or to manage the legacy of the communist past. So what is the main point here is that by historizing the caesure, so-called caesure or zero-hour narrative, which refers to 1991 as a radical breakup with the past, we shall consider the developments surrounding the state and also the dates I have referred to, 1945, as part of more extensive and complex processes of transition or transformation in various spheres of life. Let us observe how the political scientists have illustrated the complexity of post-communist transformation during this period. This graph is from a recent book entitled The Anatomy of Post-Communist Regimes. This book published by CU Press in 2020 provides a systematic mapping of possible communist trajectories by exploring structural foundations of communist regimes development, types of state, emphasizing informality and patronalism in this case, variety of actors on political, economical, political spheres, role of media, and some other factors. This book argues that previous studies were not very successful in defining the post-communist regimes, since they were trapped in the language of democracy, so to say, to quote the authors. So according to the majority of studies, democratization succeeded in the countries that had broken with their communist past, the new elite being able to reshape the post-communist trajectory of the country. So in other words, there was a constant expectation of linear progress toward democracy. Yeah? So there was an assumption that a liberal regime can be built on the ruins of the communist regime, and the transition to authoritarianism was expected to have a terminal station, so to say, reach a democratic peak. So this here, in fact, shows the complexity of transition. If you go to this website, you would see a rich pool of information, of visual information. So you can click on the country, and you can see this trajectory. So starting from the upper right corner, from the communist dictatorship, and coming to 2019, so to say, closer to personal democracy, if I'm referring to Moldova and Ukraine. You also can design your own, trajectory, country's trajectory, but based on the factors you are choosing from there. So it's a very useful, have recently discovered, and you can also make a comparison. So you can take two countries and see, for example, how economic factors have influenced their development. So this is an interactive map as well, so you can use it for free, and it's a very engaging. I'm not a political scientist, but I find this perspective a very useful one, because usually one treats the country, so to say, in separation, and not every time makes this useful comparison. Sometimes we disconsider some factors. So if we are talking about Moldova during the last decades, the analysis requires considering both domestic context, international factors, regional context as well, and also looking at various spheres of life. I will try to refer mainly to the last two decades, since I understood that the lectures are referring to the chronological period starting from beginning of 2000s. Main focus would be political regimes and identity issues in Moldova. Moldova's independence, as I mentioned, was proclaimed in 1991. In the Transnistrian region, let's go a bit to the map. So on here, let's see if it works. So it's here. So today, so-called de facto Transnistrian state. Pro-Russian groups sparked an insurgency. So it was a dramatic situation in the first part of 1992. Around 1,000 people died. A peace agreement put an end to this fighting in July 1992. However, the Russian troops never left the region. So the separatists have been able to retain control over the regions ever since. Experts, political scientists, speak of the frozen conflict, which has remained a hindrance to Moldovan's development up to today. Until the Communist Party took power in 2001, and let's go back to this triangle, Moldovan politics was characterized by high political instability with a highly fragmented party system. The post-communist nomenclatura has gained seats in the parliament, and a policy of partial reform was conducted. So the parliamentary system did not serve as a driving force towards reforming Moldova. After 2001, here you cannot see the chronology, nevertheless, let's imagine that at least on these interactive maps, it's shown that from communist dictatorship, sorry, I'm forgetting that I can't show communist dictatorship, and then slowly Moldova is moving to personal democracy, then to the south, to autocracy, and in the middle of, 5 or 6 years ago it was here. I will try to explain a bit how the party system has changed and how did Moldova reach this paternal democracy. According to the constitution, Moldova was a parliamentary republic and still is, but the decision at this time, I mean, I'm referring at the beginning of 2000, was taken by the president, Vladimir Voronin, who managed to create a fake stability. At the beginning of the mandate, he was unambiguous pro-Russian, believing that Kremlin could help him to restore Moldova's territorial integrity. He initiated numerous concessions to Russia. For example, special status for Russian language, preferential conditions for Russian investments, regular payment for Russian gas imports. Nevertheless, it was not sufficient for the Kremlin to withdraw support for Transnistrian leader Igor Smirnov. So there was a conflict in there. And in November 2003, the Voronin rejected the so-called Kozak memorandum for the federalization of Moldova. So the Russians proposed, in order to resolve the Transnistrian conflict, an asymmetrical federation should be built in Moldova. So Transnistria and also the southern part, Gagauzia. It's better to show the here. So you see the here is a Gagauz autonomous republic, so with a Gagauz majority. Transnistria and Gagauzia would receive a permanent right of veto in the Moldovan parliament and the right of veto in the formed Moldova's federal constitutional court. So there was no federal constitutional court that's supposed to be set up. So the memorials stipulated as well Russian guarantees, including continuous deployment of the Russian forces in Moldova, Moldovan territory, until 2020. So Voronin rejected this memorandum, and Russia's inflexibility on this question made him swing to the West. What has happened? Voronin has managed to surpass even the opposition in promoting Moldova's EU integration project. In November 2004, Moldova signed the action plan with Brussels and pressed for more active EU involvement in the Transnistrian conflict. So in response, the EU decided to send a representative to Chisinau on the Transnistrian issue. we come to 2004, the Orange Revolution in Ukraine. This situation placed enormous pressure on Moldovan's communist elite to respect the rules of democratic regime. And again, the communists succeeded to seize the initiative by inviting many high-ranking European and U.S. observers to ensure free elections. So the communists wanted to prove that a Moldovan revolution, if it materialized, would lack the legitimacy of the revolutions in Ukraine or Georgia. So the communists succeeded to stay in power till 2009, so 8 years, Moldova being the latest of the former Soviet republics to follow the revolution trend. April 2009, Moldova became visible in the foreign press. There were many publications about street protests directed against the alleged elections fraud of the Communist Party. And this event received the name Twitter Revolution due to the extensive use of social media channels in mobilizing the participants. So after this event, a coalition of four right center-right parties had replaced the 8-year communist rule. So the so-called political deadlock finalized. As I have mentioned, the protests were directed against the alleged election fraud of the Communist Party, which was presented in the interconnectedness with the chain reactions, the so-called color revolutions, which took place in former Soviet republics. So the Twitter revolution has, as a consequence, has raised the expectation for change within the Moldovan society. Similar to other cases, the mobilization activity has declined in Moldova as soon as the power was taken over by this four pro-European forces, parties. Due to the weak civil society, people participation in decision making remained limited. What the new political power did, it engaged in corruption schemes which surpassed by its proportion and damage the schemes carried out by the communist regime. It was precisely the Euromaidan that propelled Moldova back onto the geopolitical stage of Eastern Europe, raising the interest of the EU and the US towards the country. So the peaceful protest in Kiev, as you might know more about this event. So other cities against the refusal of the Ukrainian ex-president Yanukovych to sign the EU-associated association agreement in November 2013 in Vilnius, which turned into a wave of pro-EU protest followed by Crimean crisis, had enormous consequences for the countries in the neighborhood of Ukraine, and especially with reference to Moldova. The moment of Moldovan success in Vilnius, so Moldova having signed the EU association agreement, was merely presented as a contrast to the Ukrainian failure to sign the agreement, rather than a result of an intense negotiation process of Moldovan elite, Moldovan authorities, which was not only 1 year work on this, so with the EU that had paid off. The rise of tension inside Ukraine and the subsequent loss of Crimea to Russia channeled European integration debates towards a new topic. So, although the focus remained on the advantages and disadvantages of EU integration, it was the issue of territorial integrity that dominated the political discourse and media coverage at this time in Moldova, and also about Moldova in the foreign media. So the topic of Moldova's territorial integrity was formulated more dramatically since 1992 when in Transnistria military conflict escalated. So annexation of Crimea by Russia brought an immediate reaction by the Transnistria authorities, which expressed the willingness to merge with Russia. Here is a quotation. So a statement by the so-called Minister of Foreign Affairs, Minister of Foreign Affairs of Transnistria. So, can you please read, or shall I also read? The results of the referendum in Crimea correspond exactly with the result of Transnistria's referendum of September 17, 2006. So, 8 years ago. At that time, more than 97% of voters supported the independence to be followed by Transnistria's free accession into Russia. More than 78% of voters took part in the voting. Such a clear correspondence of the will of the Crimean and the Transnistrian people show that the Russian world is reviving and people's wish for unity will not be inhibited, unquote. Yeah, so in the new external circumstances, the separatist region of Transnistria that has challenged Moldova's territorial integrity for more than two decades has become a potentially destabilizing factor for Ukraine as well. So the presence of the Russian troops in Transnistria was the primary source of worry, as Russia could use this territory to destabilize the region's situation further. Despite the hopes, as you could see from this quote expressed by the Transnistrian side, and also you could see Transnistria reappearing in the Russian media, which were ready to develop the successful Crimean scenario for the Transnistrian Russia. So in danger, they were saying in the media, Transnistrian Russian-speaking population. So the application effort in the Transnistrian case failed. The long-asserted goal of the Transnistrian authorities to recognize the independence was not in line with Russia's plans. At that time, undoubtedly, Russia had strategic interests in the region, but did not show any readiness to expand the territories further. Yeah, so Moldovan authorities were obviously very much concerned, but the concerns were not limited to Transnistria. As I have shown already, Gagauzia, so the autonomous region of Gagauzia, and it's a majority of Gagauz live, so Gagauzian leaders, in fact, claim that they supported Moldovan territorial integrity and unity. At the same time, they warned that they would, if the country changed its political status, here the union of Moldova with Romania was meant, although there was not very much discussion at this time. Nevertheless, there were discussions about Moldova merging with Romania through EU, so to say. So if the country would change its political status, so the region would secede, so would become independent. In February 2014, the referendum, so another referendum was carried out in Transnistria, which revealed the great support of the population for Eurasian custom union option. So 98% of the 70% turnout voted for the Eurasian custom union. Contrasting the situation with the growing interest for the European Union as a sign and the signing of the EU agreement. Despite the internal and also external pressure, the Moldovan government coalition openly supported the country's advancement toward the EU, a strategy which was seen as offering guarantees of territorial and economic security. So its position was backed by enormous, by impressive, in fact, number of EU and also the US officials who visited Moldova during 2014-2015 often on their way to Kyiv through Chisinau. So the media worldwide simultaneously published more about Moldova than during the entire period, so the entire previous decade. On 27 June 2014, Moldova, Ukraine and Georgia signed the association agreement with the EU. So it's not a final goal, but the accession was, the leaders of the three countries expressed their determination to work towards the EU membership. So as you can sense, this was so the Moldovans gained a feeling of a hope, so to say, that something might change in their country, in the history of their country. There were some groups, younger population as well, were excited about the coming change. Nevertheless, I would like to throw your attention to another phenomenon which occurred in 2014, exactly when the trust of Moldovan citizens in the European coalition government has arisen. Over 1 billion Moldovan lei were stolen from the state budget through an elaborate scheme involving three banks. So as a result, so the so-called billion fraud, as a result, the state was forced to step in to bail the bank out, protecting the position, but also creating a hole in the public finances, equivalent to an eighth of GDP. So the so-called bank fraud is still under investigation. The culprits remain at large, and the money has yet to be recovered. The political regime, if we go back to the scheme I was showing you, the political regime between 2016 and 2019 was called by scholars the patronage autocracy. So if you look at the interactive map, you see in this period of time Moldova down this corner. Its main characteristic of this so-called paternal autocracy, which obviously a political scientist can better explain to you, is the use of power of the state, judiciary, and prosecution by a small group of elite. In our case, it was led by Vladimir Plahotniuk, who was a vice member of vice president of the parliament. So he was an upper elite, but not in executive power, while being rather immune to internal attacks, or called mafia state, you can find also in the literature, was turned down with the help of external intervention. So 2019, somehow the interests of the EU, US, and Russia had coincided in this, so Plahotniuk had to leave the country. So with him, left the country, so a group of supporters, yeah? So they are under investigation now, but nobody knows where they are. During the last two decades, neither left nor right-wing parties succeeded to impose a national agenda in Moldova. So if you look through the literature, the identity issue on the one hand and the country's division between East and West were indicated by scholars as motives for failure. During the last years, nevertheless, corruption became the main agenda of the opposition party, Party of Action and Solidarity, which was mentioned by Dr. Maurer. So they succeeded in coagulating various social groups acquiring a massive vote in the last parliamentary elections, which have taken place in July this year. So they mentioned the issue of identity, which apparently divided Moldovan society. I would like to go to the second part of my presentation and talk, so examine it a bit closer. Yeah, so Since in Moldova, if you mention this concept identity or this word identity, everyone thinks about ethnic identity. It's like a rule. Yeah, so I have decided to show you two maps. So 1989, so two censuses which occurred in Moldova at this time. So there are more. 2020, there is another census, but the data are not yet official. You see, I will look at my smaller map, but probably also show you. So let's compare these two maps, which are not of different quality. Nevertheless, one sees the predominance of color. So on the left, 89, so with yellow, so as a Moldova. In fact, 1989, Moldova was still part of the Soviet Union, right? But what you see here, you see so Romanian ethnicity, which was not the case, right? So it's redone, so to say. Just to draw your attention to the fact how one should be very much attentive to the sources he or she uses in order to argue a certain point, right? So not the date, not always say the right thing, in fact. So here we have with Lila, how's it Lila? Purple. Thank you. So you have yellow and purple, majority of a population, so Romanian or Moldovan. So the majority of the population, if you ask people in the street, they call them Moldovans, right? So you need to pay attention to this moment. But also, first, how many people live or have lived in Moldova? 0.3 million people. For 2014, we have 2.8 million people. That's one moment I would like to emphasize. So in the first map, so 89, we have 65% of Romanian population. For 2014, we have 73.7. Here is a smaller, so you will not be able to see, but nevertheless, you see this circle. So 73.7 percent are Moldovans, and 6.9% are Romanians. So here you see two identifications. Nevertheless, there were complaints from people and also from NGOs, from other representative of social groups, that there was an attempt to ascribe the nation, so to say, if we use a term you can use during the Soviet times. Sometime a person responsible who would come to the census, who would come to your house, would ask, please fill in, are you Romanian? They could have asked you to fill in a specific graph. So this was first to mention, so 2014. Also, if we are talking about other ethnic groups, so in 89 we have 0.8% Ukrainians in Moldova. In 2014, we have 6.5. Russians, 13% in. You have them here. Russians is right. So you see the main cities are populated mostly so Russian speaking or people who identify them ethnically as Russians. So Ukrainians as well, here you have Russians, 13%, Ukrainians, 14%. For 2014, we have other, so 6.5 and 4% Russians. So the number of people identifying as Russians or Ukrainians has drastically diminished. Nevertheless, if we look in the south, the Belarus population, which is here, we have a slight increase in population, so around 4.5% are identifying themselves as Gagauz. Less people are speaking, around half, I think 3%, I don't remember quite right, but around 3% are speaking Gagauzian language, so identifying their mother tongue. Rather, they would say that Russian is their mother tongue. Yes. Why first of all, statistics is always interesting to have a look at. But the question which I ask with relation to identity is, to which extent the identity as a debate, because we look at it as a debate, is driven by changing norms and values within the society, which you see, so its member identified different and in a decade. In fact, the ethnic composition did not change much, if you observe. To which extent this identity is driven by changing norms and values in the society, or it's an elite-led phenomenon. If you remember, we looked at this chronology, you can observe that the region went through multiple shifts of political regimes, which successfully exploited ethnicity in favor of the state and in detriment to the inhabitants. So the pre-war 1918 nationalist movement was reduced to a group of intellectuals who formulated national and social claims. The anti-war period was characterized by a harsh Romanianization, economic, social, and cultural support being offered to the Romanians as a core nation, or called at the time Romanians, but in the Soviet time Moldovans, in the detriment of the minorities. During the Soviet period, changes in the meaning of administration and political organization of the region occurred, so Moldovans were considered less loyal to the new regime than the Russians and the Ukrainians, specifically during the immediate post-war time, post-World War II, I mean here, who were promoted, so the latter being heavily promoted in region and local positions. So the Romanian identity, in fact, was cultivated, especially in the 70s, so 60s, 70s, 80s, within the family or a very small intellectual circles. After 1991, so the Moldovans took the lead in public life due to external circumstances, mainly favoring independence. So what I would emphasize here is the greatest majority of local inhabitants remained rather indifferent to multiple modernizing and nationalizing projects based on ethnic exclusion and loyalty questioning, as I emphasized. They have chosen to adapt to the new regime. Political and social requirements were changing, so they have been adapting to these requirements in order to survive, in order to gain also personal and group benefits. There is an interesting book, if you are interested, about Southern Bessarabia, which is not a very well-known region, called Making Ethnicity in Southern Bessarabia, by a German scholar, Simon Schlegel, who showed that regardless of this regime, so looking at this multi-ethnic region, the daily praxis of ethnicity was different from the frames which were set by the state, or directed by state policies. So the multi-ethnic society, so in today's Gagauzia, let's say, and also southern Ukraine after the Black Sea, he's looking at the Ukraine region as well, which was former Bessarabia. The multi-ethnic society was fluid and changing, and for example, the phenomenon of switching ethnic affiliation according to political circumstances was present. At the same time, the state ignored the needs and the representation of people situated so-called in between these ethnic boundaries. Another aspect I would like to briefly refer to studies about so-called cultural wars. So the intense involvement in this of East European societies in so-called cultural wars with focus on belonging, citizenship, rights and identities with political within political elite and broader society. So with this cultural war perspective, a stronger attachment to national identity is argued to be developed as a response to globalization processes. So post-Soviet societies were exposed to economic globalization and the globalization of media, worldwide travel, entanglements in various cultural norms, right? So this transformation have created social cleavages between elites and ordinary people, between more the well-educated people and the less well-educated, and the religious and the secular. So the debate, Moldova is not an exception in this regard. So there are debates on the role of traditional religious values, family values, sexuality, biopolitics, race, and gender. Along with this debate, there are also the debates on mass migration and multiculturalism in Moldova, and we could see that Moldova is integrated as a region, as a research region to be researched, we also see that the national and local political elite undoubtedly used the identity discourse. Have been using and it's using in its interest. On the one end of spectrum, we have the radical pan-Romanianists who view Moldova's salvation from the economic crisis and Russian influence by in its unification with Romania. There are pro-Russian and conservative groups which called for a return to Soviet Union, so the restoration of so-called Russian world. So during the last decade, the pro-European group, and especially the party which came now to power, tried to capture this so-called cautious public, which did not trust Romania either Russia. So this contradictory identity rhetoric was sharpened significantly during electoral campaigns and economic crisis with the aim to sway the attention of the public from the major social problems. There are multiple agents involved in the discourse. Besides the political and administrative elites, there are church leaders, journalists, representatives of civil organizations, academics, and also ordinary people. The external factor are also present, so representatives, so to say, of Russia and the EU, so that they are also taking part in this debate. Russian television programs continue to be popular in Moldova, partly because of the habit of watching Russian TV entertainment shows and nostalgia for the Soviet Union among the older population. Partly because the Moldovan media market is very weak and doesn't offer strong alternatives. The Transnistrian attraction, since I have referred many times to Transnistrian attraction to Russia, can be explained in part by demographic, social, and cultural changes during the Soviet period, and by three decades of Russian constant presence in the region, from military troops to financial assistance and propaganda. Popular support appeared to have been turned into a pro-Russian stance against EU and against European integration as a future scenario for Moldova. In Transnistria, physical and informational isolation as a strategy of nation building, which was very popular during the 90s, also very much used and applied, is not feasible anymore. During the last years, Transnistrian leaders play a crucial role in the construction of a distinct Transnistrian regional identity. So why is it so? So there are clearly demarcated borders. Moldova does not control, in fact, this region. Border control physically creates this Transnistrian region. So on the one side. On the other side, different events, monuments, memorials create a subjective feeling of belonging to a Transnistrian state. So I have found very interesting studies. So rather than looking at the elite narratives and strategies of identity construction, they analyzed how young people currently living in Transnistria identify themselves. So not surprisingly, the inhabitants identify themselves as Transnistrians rather than Moldovans. So is in the context of the societal changes, resistance identity, Transnistrian identity is oriented against Moldova and Greater Romania. So in the 90s there was the focus on this orientation, but what we see in the last decade is a resistant identity against EU, against US, and against the West in general, the Western world. So Russian world and Western world. Another important actor to take part in identity and political debate is the Moldovan diaspora. So I would like to share with you a map which is designed by Dorin Lozovanu, a Moldovan geographer who is well-known in Germany and other countries. He's traveling a lot and sharing his personal research. And he was generous to share with me a couple of maps. Here we see... remember the statistic I was talking about, the diminishment of Moldovan populations. So around 1.5 million Moldovans, or a third of the population, lives and work abroad. There is more than a half of Moldovan, of all Moldovans of voting age. So most of these Moldovans went abroad to seek economical opportunity and work, often in jobs they are overqualified for. So until the mid-2000s, Moldovan migrants went to Russia mostly, but the most popular destination now lies in the West. This is thanks to a simplified Romanian citizenship process for Moldovans and the EU policy of visa liberalization. So diaspora is an essential part of the Moldovan economy. Many Moldovans, elderly, and especially elderly, and those living in rural areas, you could have sensed from the maps that the mix of the populations is to be seen, to be observed in cities. But in countryside, most Moldovans, they rely on money sent home by relatives working overseas. So in 2019, remittances made up 16% of Moldovan gross domestic product. And here's a map, a graphical representation of the Moldovan diaspora in Switzerland. a bit of touch on Switzerland, and I don't know very much about it, but we would be willing to learn, and it might be a topic for a research project for someone of you. So the active vote on Moldovan diaspora in 2020 presidential election and 2021 parliamentary election has shown a strong desire for change. The election of the pro-EU candidate for a presidency has revealed that the diaspora prefers a candidate with a clear Western EU orientation. And also has revealed that the diaspora can play a decisive role in the political processes in the country of origin. Yeah, so I am coming to the end of my presentation, but before this, I would like to show you a diagram which might be an answer to the question how the Moldova's perspective looks like today. So you see, June 2021, it's a fresh diagram based on a public opinion barometer organized by Moldovan Institute of Public Policies, which show a clear division of foreign policy choices between pro-Western EU and pro-Eastern Russia. So the question is, if a referendum on Moldova's accession to the European Union were to be held next Sunday, would you vote for or against? So you see, 65% would vote for the accession, against 25.8%. So it looks quite optimistic, isn't it? But if we look at this graph, which is also June 2021, it's another question. In your opinion, which country would be the main strategic partner of Moldova? So what do you see? You see that Russia, the percentage of people who remain convinced that Russia should remain the main strategic partner of Moldova is 32.5. And then the neighbor Ukraine comes with a bit more than 1%. So, the number of respondents is 1,161. Not very many people were asked to respond. Nevertheless, it's a quite pessimistic view. How can it be explained? So, direct dependency on energy resources is not diminished. So the recent gas crisis reinforced this idea. So and we know very well that the Russian government used both so-called gas diplomacy strategy, manipulating the prices of gas and oil for Moldova, and the so-called carrot and stick diplomacy. Earlier, for example, in 2008, imposing export sanctions for Moldovan wine and agricultural products, at the same time promising better conditions for Moldovan diaspora if Moldova mobilizes its support for the Euro-Asiatic Economic Union. Yeah, so instead of conclusions, here's a list of points. Indeed, the citizens expect qualitative changes from the new government. Yulian Ciocan, a well-known Moldovan contemporary writer and journalist, whose short interview I have recommended as reading, is one of them. So the last, if you had the possibility to read, it was not long, but nevertheless, you have probably sensed that on the one side, as a writer, Ciocan said that the last few decades was a period of opportunities, right? On the other hand, he described this period as a hell for Moldovans and the citizens who lived in this cold, a suffocating and a complicated environment, end quote. So along with the disappointment with the current situation, the author was expressing high expectations from the new political regime, which declared itself a pro-European one. So this list of points can be viewed in different ways. So these are wishes, these are electoral slogans as well. If you look at the presidential campaign of 2020 and also the parliamentary campaign 2021, we see this electoral slogans everywhere in publications and in discourse and so on. We can sense them. This electoral campaign now became a political agenda for the governing party. But they hopefully they might turn into achievements. So under these conditions, the tensions between the legacies of the past, the historical attachment to Russia, and the growing attraction toward the West and the EU can be dealt with a less discursive, but hopefully a more pragmatic way. I am thanking you very much for your attention, and I'm looking forward to your questions and comments. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your discussion. Also for the finish with the wish list, or rather to-do list for Moldova. And not only Moldova, but I think it's a good place to start with the discussion. Is there a question right away?
Thank you very much, Svetlana, for the insights in an area where we know very little about. I'm interested, as you showed these different belongings, how can people be mobilized today? Do you see any patterns to mobilize the voters in Moldova for a pro-EU or pro-Russian movement? What are the factors, or what are key elements of mobilization? Is it nationalism? Is it welfare? Is it freedom? Is it belonging? Is it culture? Because we have comparable movements in other countries, and I'm always interested, how can people be mobilized for political thinking or direction? Where do you see the main focus in the perspective for the last years?
Thank you for your question. Yes, I have talked about mobilization. Yeah, so mentioning this word, and also that the mobilization, is always present as a term, in especially in electoral campaign, right? Nevertheless, it's not only about mobilizing the voters, because elections come and go, and changes are not very often to be observed. So it means that there is a challenge not only for the government, or for the governing party right now, which is a pro-EU and shows not only interested but also concrete steps toward small steps, of course, but nevertheless direction is shown, and there are groups of people, more than 1 million people voted for this party, so that's what the voters wanted. They wanted this change. And I have mentioned that fighting corruption, or fight against corruption, was a mobilization slogan. So because of this bank fraud, and because of this old elite is passing, so to say, the new elite clans were coming in. This network of the elite, which is not only local and the country, but also regional network of elite, including Transnistria, including Ukraine and Romania. So the people have understood that they need to do something. They need to elect a force or elect a party which would assume this task to fighting corruption. So mobilization slogans can be different, can be against corruption, but what comes next? Next comes the willingness to live in a better economic condition. So the welfare message is there, so it is promoted by the political elite. Nevertheless, the participation, so social participation, should be, in my opinion, part of this mobilization campaign, and not only in the election, as I mentioned. There are a couple of researchers who have written about the way the Moldovan society has mobilized itself during the corona time, at the beginning of corona, showing that there is potential for younger people, for different social groups to come together and help those in need, regardless of the location, regardless of social status, regardless of ethnicity, and so on. So there is a potential to show solidarity, and not only in discursive way, but also contribute and organize themselves. So there is a possibility to mobilize people, not only for big political goals, but also for daily life. So daily life matters, especially in difficult conditions. And we have some social groups, vulnerable groups, as I said, elderly, and also younger people living in the countryside. The conditions are poor, and they need also, besides political mobilization, besides policies, they need also grassroots initiatives that might contribute to the changing, also to better living condition, but also to changing the mentality of people, that there is a possibility for these countries to develop. Thank you. Sie können auch auf Deutsch fragen.
Ja, vielleicht auf Deutsch. Also Sie haben jetzt hier über die Möglichkeiten von oder das Potenzial von dieser Mobilisierung gesprochen. Wie ist es denn so quantitativ? Also dieses Land hat viele Wechsel erlebt in der Regierung, ohne große Changes, wie sagt man, ohne große Veränderungen, so wie Sie gesagt haben. Wieso, also wie sieht es aus in der Quantität, ist jetzt mit dieser neuen Regierung mehr, wie sagt man, mehr von dieser Energie zu spüren für einen Wechsel, oder wie sieht das aus? Es hat ja eine große Kultur von Migration auch. Wie sieht es aus? Entschuldigung.
Sie meinen von quantitativ. Strategien, oder?
Nicht die Strategien, aber mehr von vielleicht vom Barometer auch, oder von vielleicht vom Vertrauen auch in die Regierung oder in das Potenzial.
Yes, so I'll try to. There were many components of the question, but I will try to answer. As I mentioned, also the potential for mobilization can come from outside, right? So this diaspora, which is present and also influence the situation inside the country, not only by sending remittances, but also by co-participating in various initiatives, and also initiating some interesting projects. For a week or so, the government made a call for people from diaspora to come home and contribute directly to the change, become part of the government, to fill in the positions, which are, there are many open positions now in the government structures. Nevertheless, so one senses skepticism, right? So one counts, when it comes to the open call, is okay, but when you count what is the situation here, how a family have achieved at least more or less better economic status, and what would cost, so to say, to come back. So of course it's not it's also about enthusiasm, not only about money. Nevertheless, enthusiasm is vanishing very quickly, right? So I would say that Moldovan government should not count on mass return, so to say, of Moldovan diaspora back, but use this potential, right? So if you are talking about the strategies of mobilization, not only saying diaspora come home, but use the potential, the professional achievements of people, consultancy, and so on in different fields, which might go beyond, so to say, individual contacts. Yeah, so might achieve. Might come connections between groups or institutions, and often not necessarily governmental at the governmental level. So to say, the exchange of people, but also exchange of practices, of good practices, of knowledge from this. Countries I was showing you here. So Moldovan diaspora is big in Italy, for example, and also in the UK, in comparing to Switzerland, right? So there is a potential, and there are so this Twitter revolution, so to say, you can follow it also in with regard to Moldovan diaspora, which mobilizes itself via Facebook or via other socializing means, and also initiating interesting project, which so going directly to people, to village, to cities, to reaching out to people who would need this help. And it's, as I said, it's not only about money; it's about long prospect initiatives. Which I hope I have understood your question correctly.
Yeah, maybe. If you can very shortly say something about the energy of the people, or it sounds a bit pathetic, but with so many
so regime switches, you mean? Yes,
so
so. You mean from this population movement, one cannot, in fact, so to say, predict or migration waves. There were migration waves, if we are referring to diaspora, but there was in beginning of 90s or middle of 90s, and also after 2009, one can observe, so when the pro-European parties came to power, there was a stagnation in migration for a couple of years. I mean, not a proper stagnation, nevertheless, one observed this from the statistics. And now in the last years, from the middle, after this so-called bank fraud, again, there was a rise in migration. So one can observe. So the developments that take place in Moldova are directly proportional with what was happening with the decision that people take. So this should be taken into account. So it's not easy to estimate the mood of people in Moldova, and sometimes you hear that you say Moldovans don't smile too often, but this might be subjective. Assumption. It's not because people are not cheery and not hospitable, and but because maybe of the burden they carry. From daily life, and one can see this among the older population specifically. Yeah? So it's not even about nostalgia. It's for the former, so for the Soviet times. It's about the former intelligentsia, which, as Ilyanchuk Kant have mentioned, beginning of night, there was so much enthusiasm, you know, going out on the street, waiting for change. Some perspective, somebody looking right to Romania, somewhere considering Moldova capable of reaching a certain level of development. But this enthusiasm has vanished, and so 30 years, so people in their 40s are now in 70s and say, what we have achieved, why our children are outside the country, and why we worked hard the whole life, and now we have a very small pension, and we are not expecting support of the state the level we would like to. Yes, so some other reflections, maybe not necessarily questions, maybe to what you have encountered or heard about Moldova and or about the region, or the way we can also think about it. And so not necessarily from the perspective I was talking about. So.
I have a question to the language, because also language could be part of the identity, and with so many ethnicities, so is there a problem with the language, or what is the main language?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. It's a very pertinent question. In fact, I had a whole page about language. I had to cut it. I mean, I have thought about language while preparing this presentation. We have official Romanian language in the interwar period. So if we are looking at this chronology again, 1918-1940, so Besarabia being part of Greater Romania, so it was a Romanian language. Then we, at the same time, in Transnistrian region, which was part of the, was formed the Moldovan autonomy, so-called Moldova Autonomous Republic during the interwar period, which was part of Ukrainian Soviet Socialist Republic, there was a Moldovan language there, and with Cyrillic script. In the 1933, the script was replaced with a Latin script, and the 1937 again with Cyrillic script, and the intellectuals who have made this change, written textbooks, and published academic papers were deported and sentenced to Siberia. You probably have heard about the Great Purge in Soviet Union. So there was also Moldovan Autonomous Republic affected. During World War II, so we have Moldovan SSR again, the switch to Moldovan language, and Romanian again, switch to Romanian official, but coming to the Soviet Union period, so there was a Moldovan language with Cyrillic script, right? And 1991 is the constitution, so a couple of years ago, 1993 was a constitution adopted. The Moldovan language was indicated, so Article 13, if someone says in Moldova, Article 13, everyone knows what it is about. So the language is Moldovan. When we go into schools, you see Romanian language and literature as subjects. Right, so Romanian history is subject. Nevertheless, in the constitution, so there was no majority of parliamentaries who would change this Article 13 in the constitution to readjust, so to say, the societal changes. In 2015, 2015, I think, there was a decision of Constitutional Court which says that Romanian language is the official language of the country. Nevertheless, there was not a change in the Constitution. Now we can observe open letters of the academics, intellectuals, insisting on a new parliament, parliamentary, to vote, which is a majority now, pro-European majority, to vote for this Article 13. Yeah, so the responses are various. They say there is no time now. We have a crisis. We have economical issues. We don't have time to to deal with this topic, which is not stringent, right? So one can interpret different this. So this responses, which I also can comment as a private, so to say, responses. Not private, okay, a deputy is not a private person, but I mean personal opinions, not a party opinions of the opinion of the whole parliament. So as I have mentioned, the issue of identity, and also here counting also the issue of language and ethnicity, is coming up in the situation when the economic tension is there. For example, now with the gas crisis, right? Would have been very easy to talk about these issues, to withdraw the attention of the public, to form this difficult economic situation, which was every time. So the communists have managed this issue of language and to bring up to the public discourse specifically in this period. So I don't think the Moldovans have a big problem with this. So as I said, for example, in 19 during World War I, if you look in the sources, you can find various identification in the same source. I have a great example is actually belongs to our Moldovan well-known historian Andrei Kushko, who analyzed a source in which you can find Bessarabian, Moldovan, right? So you find many identification in one document. So it's not a problem for Moldova, and I think it's not very much in the public debate anymore as it was at the beginning of 90s in relations with Transnistrian conflict. And identity became a topic, not a hot topic at this point. So I am a Moldovan, I speak Romanian, for example. You can hear this. Identifying with a citizenship of the country and pointing at official language, the one would please. I don't see also a problem in this. Thank you.
Okay, I think our time is more or less up now. Any last short questions?
Yes.
So you mentioned the tendency for people to leave Moldova.
Sorry, I don't hear you properly. Can you?
Okay. So you mentioned the tendency of Moldavian people to leave because of economic possibilities in other countries. And I feel like on the map, you showed for Switzerland there was a tendency for more females to be in Switzerland. And is that a tendency that is European wide or not? Or on the next map, I think, should be. Yeah.
Here?
Yeah.
Female, am I right? So if I understood you correctly, you want to need to refer to this gender issue within the migration, the greater migration tendency, right? So if we are talking about beginning of 90s, there were more women who migrated, especially in the West, in Italy also, and men to Russia. So they worked in the construction. So it's not only women migrating to West and men, women to East, but one can observe this gender criteria when counting, so to say, how many people migrated where. This is not because of political preferences, but obviously because of the work available on the market, so to say. Yes, yeah, so now it's not the case anymore. Before there were, so there was one family member who would migrate, for example, and send, so sustain his family at home, and either being man or a woman, so husband or wife. Now the family migrate, so those who have migrated have invited their families, or so family reunions have happened the beginning of 2000 or the, so a decade ago. So now it's the cases of only one family member migrating are not very, are not predominant, I would say. This is one moment. So 2000 is a, yeah, there was a generation of children left at home without one or two parents. Sometimes mother and father were working abroad, and the child was used to be grown up grandparents, which I see as a social tragedy. So there are many, many cases in which, emotional breakdown is there, so the incertitude is there, the impossibility of the state to act, to offer support, even social support. We didn't have social workers. We have it for a decade, I think. So we didn't have social workers as a profession. So a social worker in the village, now it's just one social worker, I don't know, 4,000 or 5,000 people, so maybe two, but in small villages, sometimes there is no social worker to rely on. So the children were sometimes not even, going to school. So school had to look for children, and so many cases which are not very pleasant to think about, so happened this time. So now it's another generation of children, nevertheless, it's there are children, Moldovan children, who are brought up abroad and don't even speak their native language. This is also, shall be looked at, from different perspectives.
Thank you very much. Thank you again, everyone, for discussing. Thank you so much for the presentation. Now I wish you all a nice evening, and we'll see each other in 2 weeks' time, but online. And yes.
I also thank you very much for the presence and for your interest in this topic, and I wish you all the success in the future.